This evening's program is one of over 200 public community outreach programs held each year here at International House. Whether it's a world music or dance performance, a lecture, a conference, or a symposium, International Film Festival, or a cultural celebration, International House presents public programming that advances cross-cultural understanding and promotes opportunities for civic discourse on community, national, and world affairs. These programs would not be possible without the support and collaboration with organizations across the campus and from around the Chicago area, including tonight, our partners, Argonne National Laboratory, the Office of the Vice President for Research and National Laboratories, and the University of Chicago Alumni Association. On behalf of the International House community, I want to thank you all for coming this evening, and I look forward to seeing you at many of our future events. And now I would like to introduce Tracy Quinn, Assistant Vice President for National Laboratories, to begin our program. Thank you all for coming.
Thank you, Denise. So for those of us who have the opportunity and the honor to work at great institutions like Argonne National Laboratory and other great national laboratories across the country, we know that we work with superstars every day. But tonight we have a special treat, because we're not only going to have the chance to hear from a superstar scientist, but also a super screen star. And what a chance that is. Tonight's program is an encore presentation of a popular public lecture series sponsored by Argonne National Laboratory called Argonne OutLoud. Now, most of you probably know Argonne. It's a national lab located about 25 miles west of the University of Chicago campus, and it's an outstanding institution that brings together the greatest researchers, scientists, and leaders in such areas as high-performance computing, energy, technology, national security. It's also the home for our great speaker tonight. Argonne OutLoud has received rave reviews from community members who live and work near Argonne. So we decided that it was time to bring all the benefits of Argonne OutLoud here to the University of Chicago. And this is one of the first programs that we'll have in that regard. For audience members here and those who will be tuning in via video conference, please use the Twitter heading, the Twitter hashtag ScienceAndCinema if you'd like to post pictures, share comments, or have thoughts. Tonight, we are here to have some questions answered that I think are burning for all of us. We want to know, how did a chemist, a scientist who had never acted before or had ever done any work within the United States from a film standpoint, become a reoccurring character on one of the nation's most, and really the world's most popular series? And what parallels does our speaker see between the scientific process and the filming process? We are very pleased tonight to have Dr. Marius Stan as our speaker. Most of you probably know him as Bogdan, aka Eyebrows, who was the car wash owner and the one-time boss of the show's main character, Walter White, played, of course, by Bryan Cranston. In fact, Marius is a senior scientist at Argonne in the Nuclear Engineering Division and a senior fellow at the Computation Institute. Marius came to Argonne and to the University of Chicago in 2010 from Los Alamos National Lab. He's a physicist and a chemist interested in, wait for it, non-equilibrium thermodynamics, heterogeneity, and multi-scale computational science for energy application. He is also the technical director of the Nuclear Engineering Advanced Modeling and Simulation Program. He now also knows a bit about car washes. So before we bring Marius to the stand, we'd like to show you a brief video that gives some background on Dr. Stan's extraordinary story and that also touches on some of the themes that we will hear from tonight.
The real important thing, and not everyone knows this, is to be tough. Boss has to be tough. Has to say no to people. Has to make cashiers wipe down cars, even if they don't want to. Can you be tough, Walter?
I have to say that I never thought I'm gonna be acting in any movie or TV series. A few years ago, I joined my children for an audition for the pilot of Breaking Bad. It was an exciting moment for them. Little did I know that it's gonna be an exciting moment for me too. During that audition, somehow the production thought that I might be a good choice for a character to say one line in the pilot. And then it happened that Vince Gilligan and the production liked me in that role, and every season brought this character, Bogdan, the owner of the car wash, back for a little bit. I do believe that scientists and movie makers are creators, are people who are driven by curiosity, by the need to communicate knowledge in the case of scientists and emotion in the case of artists, of movie makers. Both fields are interested in developing and maintaining forces between atoms, in the case of the scientific models I'm working on, or between characters and people in movie. And this attraction and rejection between entities is a theme that reoccurs in many of the scientific papers we published, and that can be retrieved in some of the movies I watched. And I found it intriguing, interesting, and somehow providing an unexpected link between science and cinema. So after all these, I would encourage everybody to go to an audition. If they're interested in being part of a movie, there is nothing more interesting than go there and try to be part of the movie making experience. I found it very rewarding. I also encourage people to try computational science. Run something that will give you the sense of what we do as computational scientists. And with that, maybe we will get more people interested in doing either of them or both of them.
So enough lead-in. It's time to now introduce, and it's my great privilege to turn to Dr. Marius Stan.
Thank you. Yes, you remember me. We just took pictures a few minutes ago. I'm so happy to see how many people braved the cold weather to come to this event. I'm glad to be here. Thanks, University of Chicago, for inviting me. I also like to thank Argonne National Laboratory for sponsoring most of my scientific work, and Alex Mitchell for his contribution to organizing this series of events. The Computation Institute, I am a fellow of the Computation Institute, and Rob Mitchum helped me get some of their very interesting results that I'm gonna discuss in this talk. And not a scientific entity, but a very, very interesting company, Sony Pictures Television. My thanks for producing what some people think is one of the best TV series ever.
Good. I don't want her coming back with more demands. She gave me a hard time when we settled on price.
We're all on the same page, Bogdan.
Okay, so that Romanian accent and broken English that I use in the scene was on purpose. The accent and English I'm using now is unintended. So. You know, Bogdan Wolynetz, the character you just saw, is in fact a real person by now. Lives downtown Chicago, somewhere in the Printer's Row, next to Millennium Park, next to, not far, two blocks away from the Buckingham Fountain. And people stop this individual on the street with saying, oh my God, oh Meg, take a picture of you. Or are you an actor? Or, hey, Bogdan, how are you? Can you sign this for me? There is a Wikipedia page for Bogdan Wolynetz. You can say it says eyebrows of doom. He's a male Romanian-American, so am I. Alive, status, alive. He's not dead. I share many things with this character, and I'm glad whenever there is something good associated with him. For example, there is a Facebook page dedicated to Bogdan's eyebrows that I encourage you to visit. It's quite interesting. And here are some blog entries. You know, the first one doesn't look like a happy man. He's fairly old, in his 60s. No, I'm on the wrong side of 50s. But approaching 60s, I have still close to a decade until that. But I want to protest. I think people in their 60s are fairly young. So this is, plus, look, he has a tumor that is incorrect. That is, his wife wants to move back to the old country, not to my knowledge. His mistress needs a new car. That is true. So many things like that make me, in fact, like this individual, Bogdan Wolynetz. What used to upset me was that people would not know my name. They would come to me, hey, Bogdan, but nobody knew my name. Then I realized that it's right to be that way, that in fact it is this fictional character that people love, like, want to take pictures with. As far as Dr. Marius Stan, the nerd, who's giving a talk to you this evening, it looks like I'm senior in all respects. Take a look. I'm a senior computational energy scientist at Argonne National Lab. I am proud to be a senior fellow of the Computation Institute at University of Chicago. So this is a home for me. I'm home here. And also at Northwestern, also senior advisor. So all these senior positions are most likely due to the fact that I have gray hair. And I'm never successful in getting any discounted movie theater ticket claiming that I'm a senior fellow here and there, or they don't believe me. They don't think that is what it takes. But Dr. Stan's eyebrows are famous in some scientific circles. Some communities, the work I do as a computational scientist, you know what a computational scientist is? Scientist that solves physics, chemistry, materials, astronomy problems using computers instead of experimental devices. That is what I do. And here are some things that people actually said to me during scientific meetings. Oh my God, it's rare to use oh my God in the context of science. It's usually reserved for Bogdan. But so nice to finally meet you. I read all your papers. That would make two of us. I was impressed. And then, you know, a professor at a university, a very prestigious university, said, I use your multi-scale diagram to teach my computational classes. I was so proud. And then somebody approached me and said, your talk was outstanding. May I take a picture with you? And you know, my heart was pumping. I said, this person recognizes me as a great scientist. And then she whispered, I love Breaking Bad. What do we need to create a good movie or a successful scientific project? First of all, I would say a good script. For those of you who never had a chance to see how a script for a movie or for a TV series looks like, here is a fragment from episode 311, I believe, from RBQ. This show benefited from the contribution of extraordinarily talented writers, more than a dozen. They would meet every Tuesday with Vince Gilligan, the creator, and go over the episodes they just wrote, and maybe three or four in advance. They would not write the whole series, or just three or four in advance. In the script, in a specific format that you can see here, they give some suggestions to the director and to the actors about what to do. Saul frowns, raises an eyebrow, sounds sad. And what to say, of course. Walks off, what was that you? But also some guidance to the production team regarding who should be on the set and do what. Look, a bushy eyebrowed man stands in the wipe down area berating an employee. That would be me. That was me. We can't hear what he's saying, but the fans will recognize him as Bogdan. So I was already happy that there was this part here. The fans, I had fans by then. It was just season three. It is very useful to have an outstanding, an exceptionally well-written script. But we do have good scripts in science, too. Maybe not as explicit, not scripts that will tell us exactly what to say and what to do. But the scientific method that many of you maybe are using in your research, if you do research at the university, in the lab, the scientific method provides a path and very important steps towards achieving a good scientific result. We make an observation, we ask a question, formulate a hypothesis, after that create a model, and make predictions using that model, and validate, make sure that what we predict represents reality. And if everything goes well and we don't need to go back to re-examine our hypothesis, we will communicate our results. We write papers in scientific journals, books, give presentations. So science is not that different from movie making in this respect. We need good scripts and outstanding writers. Do you recognize this extraordinary scientists that changed for the better theory, experiment, and computation? If you don't, we can talk after the presentation. A good team is also necessary, no matter how good the script is. If you don't have people to team up with, it's very difficult to do anything by yourself. So I was fortunate to work with quite exceptional, innovative, creative, computational scientists at Argonne National Laboratory. Here are some of them. You don't know any of them, perhaps, by name, or if you would cross paths with them on the street, nobody will say, hey, are you, oh, here is a computational scientist from Argonne. Let's take a picture with him. But in their area, they are quite well acknowledged. Their reputation is very high. Some of them are at the top of their field, and they work and live here in Chicago. I'm proud to be associated and to work with them the same way I was very happy to be part of the Breaking Bad family. These are pictures taken at the Hollywood Celebrity Cemetery. I'm not kidding. We had a superb party organized for watching live the very last episode of Breaking Bad, season 5, the finale. Those of you who saw it, spectacular episode. Everybody was there excepting Anna Gunn, who could not make it. But you can see Bryan Cranston, Aaron Paul, most people from the cast. This is Vince Gilligan, the creator of the show, genius, in my opinion, in his work, but also in the way he's able to bring people together and create an environment that is most creative. I really like him, and I owe him the participation of myself and my eyebrows in this series. Bryan Cranston, of course, with my family, my two children, who are students in California now. Bob Odenkirk, you know Saul, the lawyer. There is a spin-off, You Better Call Saul. And we had an interesting chat. I said, and concluded that any lawyer has to wash his car. So who knows, we might cross paths again. Jimmy Kimmel, we had a brief discussion. And I, as I left this party and had such good memories and feelings about working on this show, I have to say that that night I had a bad dream. I dreamt that I was in Hollywood at the Academy Awards ceremony, that Bryan Cranston handed me the Oscar for the best actor in a supporting role. And I would give my thank you speech, mention my agent, my producers, but I forgot to thank my wife. And I was sweaty, I didn't know what to do. So since then, I use every opportunity to thank my wife, Liliana. She's here in the room. Thank you, Liliana, for your help, for putting up with me. Now I'm more relaxed, and I can move to another ingredient we need in both art and science, I believe. Good tools. Mike Slovis, this individual who is bold in many ways, is one of the best cinematographers that we have in the United States and perhaps in the world. He's also a very gifted director. He directed that scene between Bogdan and Walt that you saw at the very beginning. Michael impressed me with the care, time, and effort he put into selecting his lenses. He would go to an extent of maybe going through dozens of lenses and filters before shooting any scene. He wanted to be perfect. He knew that how important it is to have the right lens for the intensity, the contrast, to capture the light, to perhaps have the right ratio of shadow and light in a scene. And that was a lesson for me, that before doing anything of significance, one has to select very carefully their tools. We do use lenses in science too. I'm going to show you an experimental result. Microscopy. In this experiment, we use optical microscopy and then electronic microscopy and high resolution microscopy. Lenses, in a sense, different than Michael Slovis's, but still, to zoom in into a material, an aluminum alloy, that you can find in some of the bicycles. It looks like this aluminum alloy is a perfect material. It's shiny, polished. You would think when they make it, they make it with any fault. It's, what can I say, done to perfection. But let's take a look. As we get closer, in your lower right corner, you will see the magnification. So this is twice as large as the real object. This would be three times, four times. This is still optical microscopy. With increasing magnification, to my disappointment and maybe yours too, we discovered that this material is not perfect at all. There are some cavities that may have occurred during manufacturing. We can see the grain structure already, and that higher magnification. We observe that these grains themselves are not perfect. There are precipitates, defects at a scale that is unachievable with the naked eye. If we look even deeper, look, magnification is now 30,000. We will see these locations. These locations make that sound that you can hear. And these locations, they are very small cracks. Their length could be microns or even fractions of a micron. By the way, that is thousands of times smaller than a hair stray. We are changing techniques here and access what decades ago, when I was in school, like many of you, was impossible to see. Atoms, rows and columns, this very well-organized network, crystal structure of atoms. As of today, and you want to mark this on your calendar, we cannot see the structure of the atoms using microscopy. But when we meet 20 years from now, and I'm sure many of you will join me at that time, there will be perhaps a technology that will allow us to see the nucleus and the electronic structure of these atoms. But isn't this amazing that we have lenses in science that can take us to areas of natural systems that are inaccessible to our senses? And now I spoiled everybody's idea that a bike frame is perfect. So now I hope you're not gonna hesitate to use your bike anymore. So microscopy, experimental microscopy, is very powerful in exploring the details all the way to atomic level of materials. But we can do that with computational techniques too. These are computational lenses, if you want. In fact, these are mathematical methods that are rooted in theory and implemented in software, in codes. We write codes. Part of my life is dedicated to writing scientific codes that will help me look at properties at a very small length scale, for example, nanometers or picoseconds. Density functional theory is part of quantum mechanics. I can look at the structure of atoms. Molecular dynamics, nanoseconds, and microns, 10 to minus 6 meters for those inclined, or as I said, 10,000 times smaller than a hair strain. Molecular dynamics helps me understand interactions between atoms. These are atomistic methods where we account for each atom in the system. But then at mesoscale, there are other methods, phase field dislocation dynamics. You remember dislocation, small cracks that make that telephone noise. And then at continuum level, object the size of millimeters, inches, or meters, and phenomena that last seconds, days, hours. So more closer to the world that is visible to our eyes, at our body's length scale and at our life schedule, if you want, time scale, we can use finite element or thermochemical modeling. And we should be able to zoom in and out using these computational methods the same way we do with experiments. And here are some examples, but not on materials, because that may not be that interesting. This is an example of an atomic scale
simulation of a potassium channel. Potassium ions travel to our cells, and they play a very important role in bioelectricity, the electricity that is generated in our body, in facilitating, mediating communication between cells. Almost all the cells in our body have a mechanism for ion migration, potassium especially. This is an ion channel, and there is an observation, an experimental observation, that would be the first step in our scientific method. We find that these channels open when triggered by a certain signal, let the ions, potassium ions, to pass by, and then they close. And when they close, they stay like that for 10 or 20 seconds. Now, for a long time, it was a mystery why that happens. And it turned out that it was a computational technique that solved that mystery. You see, the green spheres are the potassium atoms. We would like to see them pass through this channel, but they do not, and we don't know why. And now the simulation will help us why. This is water. The red is the oxygen and the two hydrogens in white. The water molecules vibrate. There are only a dozen water molecules. And then somehow they flood these cavities, much like a river will flood an unlucky part of a town. And you can see how once they are in, it's very difficult for them to get out. The chemical interactions would not allow that. So it was a computational effort by Benoit Roux and his colleagues at University of Chicago that clarified this process and led to our understanding of something that was a mystery for a long time. They published that in Nature. It is an outstanding result. In a sense, they zoomed in all the way to the atomic level using software. How about at mesoscale? This is a representation of an artery, and all these blobs here are red cells of your blood. The reason they are colored differently is because they play different role in the blood flow, as I will mention. So the blue ones are the ones that are not healthy. They are called sickle blood cells. And you will see that some of them will stick to the walls of the blood vessel, while the red cells, the healthy ones, in their attempt to travel through this artery, will find themselves in a very tight space, making it harder and harder for the flow to proceed. So this is how a stroke may happen. You see how the cells are not flexible enough to bend, and in addition, the ones that got stuck to the walls prevent them from moving forward. This is very important in pharmaceutical research to determine what can one do to increase the flexibility of the cells or to prevent them to adhere to the walls of the artery. And then if we go to a higher scale, we can simulate today the blood vessels in the brain. These are a few blood vessels in some real person's brain. Information was retrieved through MRI. And the simulation of the blood flow with all the consequences, the good and the bad, is done on quite large computers. At Argonne National Laboratory, Joe Inslee and his colleagues do this type of work. So you see, for the human body, we have tools all the way from cells to the blood vessels to maybe pretty soon the brain. Tools are good, but sometimes we need larger scale capabilities, facilities. For example, in Albuquerque, New Mexico, anyone went to New Mexico? Are you familiar with the big state of New Mexico? Oh, a few. It's a the sizable state comparable to Illinois, only 1.5 million people. Not that many. The joke is that the highway police stops people just to make conversation. But there is an advantage to that. There is plenty of space for studios to be developed. High technology, very good studios. The third center for cinematography in the United States after Los Angeles and New York is Albuquerque, New Mexico. In addition, one can visit these studios. One can visit the car wash. There are people, companies giving tours of the car wash, of the house where the white family used to live. And again, one can see the meth labs. I don't think they make demonstrations or give out samples. But so the fact that Breaking Bad was shot in Albuquerque did a lot of good to the local economy. Hotels and restaurants thrived. People enjoyed that, got jobs as extras, or they worked for the production company. It's what very good for the state. Facilities are very important for science, too. You have some excellent facilities at University of Chicago for many areas of science. And Argonne National Lab also serves as home for perhaps the most powerful X-ray machine you'll find. So if you thought that the one in your dental office is powerful and they put all that lead equipment onto you, this is thousands times more powerful and can allow us to analyze in detail the structure of materials, organic, inorganic. There is also a center for nanoscale materials where they engineer at the atomic level, sometimes in multi-layers, for example, structures for electronics, for applications in electronics. And there is a leadership computing facility that brings together some of the most powerful computers that we have in the United States. Plus the electron microscopy center that one could use in principle to look into the bike frame, as we did a few minutes ago. So if you have a chance to spend the summer at Los Alamos, at Argonne National Lab, and work with the scientists there and access some of these facilities, that would be great. I am sometimes so jealous of Liliana because she works in a clean room. She has, that equipment that looks like an astronaut with protection gears, and they look so cool. Everybody goes there and takes selfies of themselves with her. And nobody wants to come to the beautiful computers that I'm working with. Coordination. So we had a good script, people, tools, facilities. We need to bring all these together. On a set, on a movie set, I was impressed by the fact that everything was scheduled to the minute. This is a call sheet that I would receive the day before shooting. And if you cannot see, let me help you. Bryan Cranston playing Walt must be for hair, show up for hair and makeup at 6:18. So it's not tomorrow morning or around 6, it's at 6:18. And then he should be on the set at 7:18. And again, for reasons that I'm not gonna discuss, needs twice as much time. 2 hours for hair and makeup. And she meets Bryan on the set. Marius Stan playing Bogdan, not having much hair, can show up at 8:30 and go there, be there at 9:30. Even the berated employee, should be there at 6:15. The poor guy had 3 hours to prepare himself to be berated. So, two cooks. So you see, very, very well organized. This was a lesson for me. It taught me that if I want to be the creator, the thinker, the free-spirited man that I would like to be, I need to be very disciplined in my daily life. And scientists are disciplined too. This is a fragment of a snapshot of the scheduling file calendar for one of the devices that can be used at the Center for Nanoscale Materials. You cannot see the names, but let me tell you, or the time, is 9:45 for 3 or 4 hours, 10 o'clock, and the 10:30. What you can appreciate is the fact that this goes from early morning to very late in the night, and also the fact that some people schedule their experiments on a Sunday or on a Saturday. This is dedication. They are driven. They're passionate about what they are doing, the same way the artists are in their craft. So now, I'm not going to lead with the slide. I'm going to ask you, what else do you think we need to make a good movie or to have a successful scientific project? An audience. But to get to present to an audience, we have to make the movie first or conduct the science first. So I guess somebody hacked into my presentation. It is money. We need money. If this is news to you, then I'm very sorry. You see, there is a scene in Breaking Bad between Bogdan and Skyler, played by Anagan. There is a negotiation, a financial encounter. And Bogdan says, $20 million, I'm not going to disclose what that was about, because no spoilers tonight, maybe some people are still watching. There was a lot of money pumped into producing this series. Each episode required $3 to $4 million per episode. However, the final episode, for example, $4.2 million, brought $8 million in returns. So if you talk about the return of investment, 100%, that is quite good. They spent a lot to make this series. And I would say that overall, cost and effort and talent, they made each episode as if it was a feature movie. I was impressed with that. We would work half a day for 5 minutes on the screen. Now, part of the money went into creating special rooms for shooting. For example, this is the office of Bogdan, the car wash owner, but it's not a real office at the car wash. And it's not a replica either. It's an office that they created to make it such that the audience believes is the car wash owner's office, but had plenty of room for the cameras to move around, for the sound people to go around. You could not do that in the real office. But that demonstrates somehow how serious they were about making quality products. And money is important for science, as I said. Maybe not $20 million, but 20 million gigaflops is what I would like to have. A flop is an operation per second. This will take us to petaflops, that is one followed by 15 zeros. Can you imagine that? Let me help you. Think of writing a check that has a one followed by 15 zeros. That would make it memorable, right? And we have at Argonne Mira, one of the top computers in the world. In a few years, I estimate that we will reach exaflops, that is one followed by 18 zeros. So now think of a check that somebody writes to you, one followed by 18 zeros. This is a tremendous amount of number of operations per second that this computer can do. But why do we need such a big machine? I showed you some simulations already. They involved quite powerful computational tools, but maybe not something like Mira. There are things that are very difficult to achieve without the help of a supercomputer. This is an example. My colleagues Salman Habib, Catherine Heitman, and Joe Inslee provided this simulation. It is a project that is astonishing. They want to capture the universe on a supercomputer. They are using over a trillion particles that they track in a computational volume, a cubic volume, that has the age of billions of years, light years. And when doing that, they would like to track, to identify things like dark matter that can explain the history of our universe, the way it expands, and it accelerates sometime. The scale here is extraordinary. This is 4,000 megaparsecs. If you don't know what that is, a megaparsec is approximately 3.2 light years. Sunlight takes 8 minutes to get to Earth from the sun. 8 minutes. Think of how far light would travel in 1 year, then 3 years, then thousands of years. This is very hard to imagine. But the density of matter is perhaps not enough detail to understand the universe. Here is we have an attempt to include in the simulation galaxies, stars, planets, if we can. Much like an observatory that will capture information about the entire universe. So I'm impressed with this simulation that is going on right now as we speak and will continue for many years. I hope I convinced you that and convinced myself that artists are interested in creating and communicating emotions, while scientists would create and communicate knowledge. And for a long while, I thought that there is a sharp distinction between the two. You go to a movie to cry, use napkins and sob, and you go to a scientific presentation to learn about numbers and technical results and plots and stuff like that. But this is true. Are there any overlaps? Is art diffusing into science and the other way around? Let's see. I'll start with a separation. Anybody saw this movie, 2011, made in Iran? A family drama won the Oscar for the best foreign film. It is indeed a tragedy what happens with these people, the way they have to part ways. Quite emotional. I was surprised and intrigued by the fact that a separation is a slide that I got from one of my colleagues, Larry Harding, a quantum mechanical calculation, atomistic calculation that resulted in in a simulation of what happens at a molecular level in neopentane. Component of fuel for cars. This is a study of combustion about how to improve the efficiency of the engines. So neopentane gets its name from the 5 carbon atoms in the middle. The hydrogens are the white, there are 12 hydrogen atoms. And you will see how in this process that is called roaming radicals, methyl, that's a carbon and 3 hydrogens, will separate from this molecule and leave behind isobutyl. That will be the rest of the carbons plus whatever was left in with the hydrogen. And this separation is very interesting in the scientific from a scientific point of view because it can give us a clue about why ignition is sometimes delayed and what can we do to control the timing of ignition. You see, the methyl goes away and then captures a hydrogen to become methane, a stable closed shell molecule, and leave behind isobutane. But these scientific results made an impression on me on an emotional level. I was looking at this as it was our family of 4 and my son leaving for college. If you look at the simulation again, You can see, here is my son going to college, and here is the tuition money going after him. So who said that science doesn't have an emotional component? Not to mention flames. I mean, what can be more impressive than this CGI, computer graphic imagery, of fire propagating through a tunnel? This is emotion all the way, but you'd be perhaps pleasantly surprised to know that the software used to create that is quite advanced and uses some of the most modern computational fluid dynamics techniques. Here's another CFD simulation of an explosion this time, but an explosion that illustrates what happened in our universe millions, billions of years ago. It's a white dwarf star. Our sun, oh, more bad news, I'm sorry, I hope you can take it. 5 billion years from now, the sun will turn into a white dwarf. All the energy in the furnace of the sun coming from fusion will go away and will become a small, round object the size of Earth. So white dwarfs are stars, are supernovae of type 1A that originate in two bodies merging, and that are able to gather from the neighboring, from the neighbors, gas and other particles. The pressure in such a supernova increases with time. And we can see in these simulations done at the Flash Center for Computational Center how that is released. The pressure is through a thermonuclear reaction that goes through the surface. And we have here 4 simulations at different resolutions from 1 kilometer to your left to 8 kilometers to your right. And you know there is a lot of science in this and very useful information. The light generated travels over half the universe. We can examine the history of our universe because of this 1A type supernovae. But isn't this beautiful too? I find it a work of art, in addition to being an outstanding simulation done, performed on one of the big computers we have. Computers, I claim, expand our brain, give us the opportunity to examine parts of the universe that are not accessible to the naked eye or to our senses. They help us understand better what happens in nature. Here's an example, a simple phenomenon like melting. Gallium is an element that was predicted by Mendeleev to exist in 1871 and discovered by a French scientist, Lecoq, 4 years later. Gallium has an extraordinary property. It melts almost at room temperature. The name comes from gallum, which means rooster in Latin, same as Lecoq in French. So the French scientist decided to, maybe also celebrating his Gallic heritage, to give it the name gallium. We can investigate the melting of gallium at an experimental level. Holding a piece of gallium in your hand will make it melt. The scientific question here is, why doesn't gallium melt everywhere at once? Why doesn't gallium turn from a solid to a liquid everywhere? But instead, there are these areas of liquid and solid coexisting. Now, to understand that, we need to look at the interactions between atoms. So we're going to build a model where 2 gallium atoms are interacting to a certain force. So if you look at that representation, so to your left will be one atom, which is a red circle, and to your right would be another one. The forces between atoms make them attract. They are attractive, bringing them together, or repulsive, sending them apart. The atoms vibrate because this attraction of repulsion. But the force is dictated, in fact, is the result of an interatomic potential. I'm here using complicated terms on purpose to make your life miserable, but bear with me, it's gonna be fun in the end. So this interatomic potential, this blue line that starts as an almost horizontal line and goes to a deep valley after that and comes up to your left, right next to the other atom. So there is a repulsive, an attractive part at the very beginning, which is pretty flat and goes deep into a valley and then comes up sharply, turning into a repulsive force next to the other atom. This is quite amazing how such a mathematical model can result in simulation like this one. This is molecular dynamics. I told you this is gonna be fun. I mean, after all, the atoms are pink. Cannot be afraid of pink atoms, right? Gallium atoms are here in the liquid state, very much disordered, to your left and to your right, and in the solid state, in the middle, more ordered. This is our orthorhombic structure. I'm drawing your attention to this interface between the two. Remember the experiment that was liquid and solid. What makes the entire system melt is the fact that this interface widens and advances. Let's take a look. You see, the poor solid is in the middle, is surrounded by the liquid, much like a small country could be surrounded by powerful enemies at the borders. And you see the liquid advances, and the solid is fighting for his life, for its life, trying to stay ordered, but it cannot, because the vibrations of the atoms have an amplitude that it's so high that it induces disorder in this other phase. So this is how things melt. That's why I'm saying that computers enhance our brain and help us understand what happens, go beyond observing what happens to understanding, which is very important in science, at least. Is there an emotional aspect to this simulation? I always rooted for the solid and hope that it's not gonna melt, but in the end, it always does. Artists are concerned with representing reality, perhaps to a higher degree than we are, than scientists. They would like to create an image or a movie that are able to convince the audience that it is truly real. That is, however, very difficult and sometimes impossible. I will let James Cameron talk about that.
You knew this would happen?
Because of the nature of this film, you know, with this alien clan, this alien culture, you know, we had a choice. We could do it with makeup, like it's always been done, you know, rubber appliance makeup. It would have looked horrible and it would have been boring and stupid and, you know, kind of blue actors running around in the rainforest in their underwear, you know, and a bunch of blue body paint. It would look terrible. And I wasn't interested in that. You know, if I was going to do this, I wanted to do it this way, which is with performance capture.
But before he could do that, Cameron first had to make sure his technology could cross what's known in robotics and animation as the uncanny valley.
Let's say this is an absolute human, and this is a, you know, kind of a talking moose. You know, as you approach human, our attraction to the character goes down. And then at the last second, just when you get to a true human look, it goes back up. Well, we needed to get on the far side of that dip in the response curve, which is called the uncanny valley. And we needed to get to the opposite side, where we believe, we don't have to necessarily believe that it's 100% photoreal, and we don't have to necessarily believe that they actually exist, but we have to believe in them as emotional creatures.
Now, as I said in my introductory video clip, attraction and repulsion is important in both science and art. And so is predicting the future, what will happen in the years to come. Some of you are fans of the sci-fi movies and like to look at hundreds of years ahead. I'm just kind of comment on the next five years and what I believe would be important developments in science that may impact in a positive way, hopefully, your life. So here, I'm not suggesting that you will be able to purchase or to buy a power plant at Walmart. I'm just saying that power plants are going to be more environmentally friendly. I expect some changes in our attitude towards the environment and the impact that we have in our quest for new energy sources. I also think that in 5 years, you would be able to exchange the battery of your car at a power station, much like you would exchange a propane tank for your grill, if you decide to use an electric car, of course. That is a big change, and it is becoming more and more likely to happen due to research such as the one performed at Argonne National Lab in an energy innovation hub dedicated to energy storage, to batteries. They want to increase the energy density in a battery 5 times, decrease the cost five times, all in 5 years. 3D printing, a component of digital, a more general concept of digital manufacturing, may become quite popular. I can imagine how, in a similar way, one can select pictures on the computer and print them somewhere at the CVS or Walgreens store. One can print real objects. I don't know, if your computer mouse doesn't work anymore, you can just select one and print it at your CVS or Walgreens. That is a big change, I would say. People will have some level of control of the products they're using. They can print parts, they can print all kinds of things. But my biggest hope comes from what is called the Materials Genome Initiative, an effort to build a knowledge base about all materials and predict their properties. In a similar way, Mendeleev predicted that gallium must exist because there was a hole in his periodic table. The same way we may have in the years to come enhanced versions of the periodic table that are valid not only for elements only, but for mixtures, for solutions, for compounds. Wouldn't that be great to pick up the best material for a certain application by querying the material's genome? The same way we use the human genome to cure some diseases or at least to get treatments. All these require a new generation of scientists and artists able to understand, at the least, a variety of technologies. In other words, able to speak different languages. I like learning foreign languages. I speak a few. Here is an example of languages you may use to use. For example, if in English you say gallium just melted, you saw the presentation. A physicist will say gallium went through a first order phase transition from solid to liquid and entropy has increased. I'm a physicist and a chemist, so I agree. A chemist will look at the chemical bonds and the interatomic distances and use the Lindemann criterion, saying that if the amplitude of vibrations exceeds 10% of the equilibrium distance, then it melts. But they all mean the same thing. Even a material scientist who looks at the group symmetry and says the symmetry of the orthorhombic gallium crystal was destroyed, it's now a liquid. They all say the same thing. Even a computational scientist, the number of degrees of freedom scales like n factorial, please restart your computer. Foreign languages, different languages in science, as well as in the daily life, are quite important. And I can see how our educational system will change to accommodate this need for multidisciplinary professions. I think another big change will happen. In addition to acquiring skills, which is traditionally the focus of high school and university programs, it was like that when I did my when I was in college and in high school, and continues to be, and it's a very important component to learn how to do well various things. There is a trend that I see manifesting itself, mostly in the last decade or so, of also encouraging students to have an impact, to make an impact, make a positive change on society. When I got my PhD, 3 journal articles were enough for a grad student. Now, undergrads publish their work in scientific journals. We had an undergrad from a university, from Cornell, who spent a summer with us, and his work was so good that we made him co-author of that paper. Artists, students who study art, they have exhibits, they show, they display their art. My wife and I were at downtown at Columbia University and purchased a painting from one of their students. And we asked her to sign it, and she didn't want to sign. She said that this is my homework. And so we said, it doesn't matter, you are an artist. Put your name on the painting. We have it on the wall, displayed it. You need to, I'm talking to the students in the room, you need to acquire skills, be good at what you're doing, but also make a difference in your field around you. And of course, the most important question is how to live your life. And part of that question, answering that question, consists in what kind of profession to choose. So I'm gonna end with my nerdly computational scientist advice to the students about how to go about choosing a profession. I'm going to use the language I know the best, which is programming language. So if you like to create something, I suggest you become a scientist or an engineer or a writer, a novelist, a composer, an actor. But if you like to serve society, then you want to be a physician, a doctor, or a soldier, or a fireman, or a professor, or a teacher. I had politicians too, but after 1 year in Washington, I removed that from. Now, if you like to tell other people what to do, but no matter what you choose to do, I would say, do it with all your heart. Thank you for your attention.
I guess I'll break the ice. Dr. Stan, thank you so much for talking. Can you tell us a little bit of how you balanced your responsibilities both at Argonne and then on set in Albuquerque? And the second part of this question is, do you see any roles for yourself in the future?
No. I'm not looking for balancing activities that much, as I'm looking for doing something that captivates me and drives me. I'm a passionate man, so whatever I do it with full energy and full force. If your question had to do with how many vacation days I used to shoot the scenes in Albuquerque, I would say that no more than maybe a couple of weeks a year. For the last part of the show, they would fly me from Chicago, put me in a hotel, and then take me to the set back. So my colleagues at Argonne National Lab did not know about this. My management knew and approved vacation. I didn't tell anybody for a long time. I very much enjoyed when they would come to my office, open the door, and say, I cannot believe this. I was watching TV last night. It took more than a year to my colleagues down the hallway at Argonne to learn about my acting career. And after that, they sent out emails and everybody. In a couple of weeks, I guess, everybody knew after that. So I try to do everything to the best of my ability. And I don't let my profession define me. I'm a computational scientist, but that I'm also an actor. I'm also a father and an average soccer player. And I'm many things, and so are all of you. But to the second part of your question, I am involved in a project that is a feature movie, not a TV series. But I'm not going to give you any hints about it. I hope you are going to be pleasantly surprised and watch your go to the movie theaters and say, hey, I know that guy. He gave a talk a few months ago.
I guess I'm just curious what you are most proud of having achieved either in your scientific career or in your acting career either, or both.
In my scientific career, I'm most proud of the fact that 15 years ago, I proposed that we develop computational method at various time and length scales, created that diagram that I showed you and that some people use to teach their classes. But more than that, I suggested and was part of the team that created the first coupled simulations. So to do molecular dynamics and finite in phase field, for example, at the same time, or to do ab initio molecular dynamics, that's quantum mechanics and molecular dynamics. You make the atoms vibrate, but then in the middle of the MD simulation, you call a routine to calculate forces, for example. So coupling these methods at different length scales is what is the contribution, scientific contribution that I'm most proud of. Nowadays, many people do that even far better than I used to. And that diagram, you will find it in a variety of places. I guess they like the color scheme, but it's quite, I would say, it's a trademark that I like and I'm proud of. In the artistic area, of course, being part of Breaking Bad is the thing that I'm most proud and I found most rewarding.
Thank you for your information and for your talk and for giving us this knowledge. But I had a question that had to do with the theme, science and cinema. How do you think that your research and what you work on at Argonne and in computers will influence popular media? For example, when I saw your cosmic simulation, I instantly thought of Dr. Neil deGrasse Tyson's Cosmos series that's really popular, and it really helped me and be more aware and more interested in science. So how do you think that your work can transfer into more popular spheres like pop culture, and how can it influence and inspire other people to be more interested in science?
So there are two ways of influencing cinematography, somehow related to the work I'm doing. Part of my work consists in designing better materials, so computational material science. So some of these materials that we design may end up in camcorders, in sound technology, in the devices that movie makers use, and in contribute somehow. Special effects, think about that. Mathematical methods and algorithms that we developed can improve the way cinematography, movie making industry uses special effects. The other way is what I'm doing right now, giving talks and advocating that scientists in general, and those with big eyebrows in particular, are very cool. And science is a profession that is not scary and could be extremely rewarding. I hope that I can attract more people to science. I hope that they will be more and more interested to learn about science, to see the fascinating aspects of scientific results at all scales. You saw from atomic scale all the way to the universe. So that is, in fact, my secret goal, that your impression and your thoughts about science have changed a little bit tonight. Many for the better, I hope, some for the worst, I don't know. This guy is really boring, and I had enough of those movies, and let's have a drink. But overall, if a few of you think that science is a cool thing to do and decide to pursue it, that would be great for me.
Hello, thank you for your time.
Hi.
I was just wondering, you said that you work with a lot of like advanced optics. So do you think that in the future you guys will be implementing Vanta Black into your microscopes or telescopes or stuff like that? And also, were you a scientific consultant for the show, and how accurate is the show's representation of science, just on a broad scale?
Okay, thank you. So I cannot answer the first question. I don't know what Vanta Black is. But we can discuss about that if you want. Regarding the second question, I was not a consultant on this show. They had their own people. The chemistry in Breaking Bad is, spectacular, but far from reality. You cannot make methamphetamine by watching Breaking Bad. They made sure of that. Don't want to be sued by anybody. Making methamphetamine is an art. I'm a chemist, I know that well. So no, I was not consulted in any respect regarding the science in the show.
Hello. So I'm quite curious about where the idea to take up acting came from. I can see why it was a wonderful idea, but it was something very new, and I don't think many computational scientists ever consider taking up acting. And I mean, what got you to do that? Was it your children, maybe? Someone give you an idea? And what were you thinking when you were there on the audition?
I was not thinking at all. Otherwise, I wouldn't have. So we were in Los Alamos. That's why at some moment I said Los Alamos instead of Argonne. I spent 13 years at Los Alamos National Laboratory in New Mexico. That's 2 hours away from Albuquerque. Our children learned about Breaking Bad being shot in Albuquerque and wanted to be extras in the pilot. There was a call. And they were minors at the time, so the parents had to accompany them, which we did. Make a long story short, we went there, they took pictures of everybody, called back, said, the Stan family is accepted, all of us, background or extras, and somebody in production asked the question, can the father say a one line? The one line was, Walt, I need you outside to wash a car. I said, not thinking, I confess that I was not thinking right. I said, sure, why not? So I went there, Vince Gilligan is the one I auditioned with, he made me say the line, and he liked me and my eyebrows, perhaps. I like to believe it was my immense talent and my eyebrow. So I went back and then I discovered that they put more lines. And then we had some discussions about some of these lines in the pilot. And in the end, I accepted and we just shot the scenes in the pilot. And then every year they called me a little bit just to maintain the interest on this character. Sometimes in season 3, I'm just hanging out in the parking lot of the car wash. But there is a scene with the car wash. And then in season 4, the action of the series moved to the car wash. And I was in more episodes, in more consistent role. But that's the story. So that's why I'm saying, go to an audition. They cannot make movies with Brad Pitt and Angelina Jolie only. They need people with big eyebrows or with no eyebrows at all. And you may be the ideal fit. to whatever they need.
Okay, so Dr. Stan will be around for a few moments after we close. I want to thank Dr. Stan for an outstanding presentation tonight, for not only bringing together science and cinema, but also bringing a large degree of humor to it. So thank you again, Dr. Stan.
Thank you.
Dr. Stan also impressed upon me as part of his presentation the importance of thanking all of the individuals that bring us forward. So I'm going to take just a few seconds and thank some of the people that made this happen today. So first, Mary Beth Stefano with the International House, Ira Goldberg, a member of the university's Alumni Association and an employee at Argonne, Zach Russ with the university's Alumni Relations and Development Office, Alex Mitchell from Argonne, and Lisa Lavalle from the university's Office of the VP of Research in National Laboratories. If you have enjoyed tonight's discussion, please visit our website, argonneoutloud.uchicago.edu, for information about future events. Thank you all for coming, and thank you, Dr. Stan.
Thank you.